The Lord is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Hallelujah. Good morning.
Good morning.
I greet you in the name of our Savior Jesus on this beautiful day that God has given to us, that we can be here in his house, gathered around his word and sacrament, always ready and eager to receive his Easter blessings. So if you would turn quickly to the announcement pages, I want to go through this as quick as we reasonably can. Obviously, VBS is coming up. That's the first thing you'll see on the announcement pages. We'll be doing that June 19th through the 23rd. So if you can be of any help to Miss Sheila, let her know. I assume you need volunteers at this point. Okay. Also, a reminder there on the bottom of that page that the second episode of Watch the Chosen with the Pastor will be taking place on Tuesday, May 23rd at 7 o'clock at the Erler residence. So we hope that you will join us for that. If you didn't come the first week and are wanting to come the second month, let me know so that we have enough room. Then, Bible breakfast will be happening a week from Saturday at 8 o'clock in our library as we do Home Run King, I think is the name of that study. I do have to correct something in the bulletin. We had announced that our next voters meeting was going to be May 28th, and that's Memorial Day weekend, and no one's going to be here. So we're going to push it to two more weeks to June 11th. We can't do it the first Sunday of June because that is the Sunday that we are confirming our next five confirmands, and I do not want to have a voters meeting after confirmation. That's just rude. So we're going to do it on June 11th, okay? Musical talent, if there's a song or musical offering that you would like to do here at St. Mark, we do want more special music than just on Easter and Christmas. If you're willing to do that, talk to Brenda Duncan and we'll get you set up there. Also a reminder that F3 has ended. It's ending with the school year, so F3 will be resuming down in August here. And this Wednesday we're having preschool graduation at 6:30, and the confirmands have their final at 5. So I see. They're ready? Okay, good to hear it. And then LWML is doing the annual Mother's Day collection of stuff for Willow, and the list is there in your bulletin, and they're also having a baby shower for Willow at your house Saturday? Okay, so if you want to get in on that, ladies, talk to Julie or Sheila or, I guess that's a good first start. Okay, so I think that's all I've got. Is there anything I am forgetting or neglecting? Awesome. Not bad for a guy who's 61. Okay, so then let's go ahead and begin with our first song here this morning, The Father's House, and God bless our worship together here today.
Shame at the door.
Congregation will please stand. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen. If you, O Lord, kept a record of sins, but with you there is forgiveness.
Therefore you are forgiven.
O Almighty God, merciful Father, I, a poor, miserable sinner, confess to you all my sins and iniquities with which I have ever offended you, and justly deserve your punishment now and forever. But I am heartily sorry for them and sincerely repent of them. And I pray you of your boundless mercy and for the sake of the holy, innocent, bitter sufferings and death of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, to be gracious and merciful to me, a poor sinful being. Upon this, your confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the Word, announce the grace of God unto all of you. And in the stead and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all of your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. You may be seated so that we can sing our next song. Piano player left, didn't she? Okay. All right. Oh, here she comes. I was just about to start without you.
Thank you.
We continue with the readings.
The first reading for today is from the book of Acts, chapter 6 and chapter 7. Now in these days, when the disciples were increasing in number, a complaint by the Hellenists arose against the Hebrews because their widows were being neglected in the daily distribution. And the 12 summoned the full number of disciples and said, "It is not right that we should give up preaching the word of God to serve tables. Therefore, brothers, pick out from among you 7 men of good repute, full of the Spirit and of wisdom, whom we will appoint to this duty. But we will devote ourselves to prayer and to the ministry of the word." And what they said pleased the whole gathering, and they chose Stephen, a man full of faith and of the Holy Spirit, and Philip, and Barachas, and Nicanor, and Timon, and Parmenas, and Nicolas, a proselyte of Antioch. These they set before the apostles, and they prayed and laid their hands on them. And the word of God continued to increase, and the number of the disciples multiplied greatly in Jerusalem, and a great many of the priests became obedient to the faith. And Stephen, full of grace and power, was doing great wonders and signs among the people. Then some of those who belonged to the synagogue of the freedmen, as it was called, and of the Syrians, and of the Alexandrians, and of those from Colchia and Asia, rose up and disputed with Stephen. And Stephen said, "Brothers and fathers, hear me, you stiff-necked people, uncircumcised in heart and ears. You always resist the Holy Spirit, as your fathers did, so do you. Which of the prophets did not your fathers persecute? And they killed those who announced beforehand the coming of the righteous one, whom you have now betrayed and murdered. You who received the law as delivered by angels and did not keep it." Now when they heard these things, they were enraged, and they ground their teeth at him. But he, full of the Holy Spirit, gazed into heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing at the right hand of God. And he said, "Behold, I see the heavens opened and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God." But they cried out with a loud voice and stopped their ears and rushed together at him. Then they cast him out of the city and stoned him. And the witnesses laid down their garments at the feet of a young man named Saul. And as they were stoning Stephen, he called out, "Lord Jesus, receive my spirit." And falling to his knees, he cried out with a loud voice, "Lord, do not hold this sin against them." And when he had said this, he fell asleep. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Christ has risen from the dead. He has given him dominion over the works of his hands.
He has put all things under his feet.
The epistle reading for today is from 1 Peter. "Like newborn infants, long for the pure spiritual milk, that by it you may grow up to salvation, if indeed you have tasted that the Lord is good. As you come to him, a living stone rejected by men, but in the sight of God, chosen and precious, you yourself, like living stones, are being built up as a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood, to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ, for it stands in Scripture, 'Behold, I am laying in Zion a stone, a cornerstone chosen and precious, and whoever believes in him will not be put to shame.' So the honor is for you who believe, but for those who do not believe, the stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone, and a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense. They stumble because they disobey the word, as they were destined to do. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for his own possession, that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who called you out of darkness into this marvelous light. Once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. The congregation will now please stand for the words of the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 14th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said, "Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. And you know the way to where I am going." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way?" Jesus said to him, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you had known me, you would have known my Father also. From now on, you do know him and have seen him." Philip said to him, "Lord, show us the Father, and it is enough for us." Jesus said to him, "Have I been with you so long, and you still do not know me, Philip? Whoever has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, 'Show us the Father'? Do you not believe that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me? The words that I say to you, I do not speak on my own authority, but the Father who dwells in me does his works. Believe me that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me, or else believe on account of the works themselves. Truly, truly, I say to you, whoever believes in me will also do the works that I do, and greater works than these will he do, because I am going to the Father. Whatever you ask in my name, this I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask me anything in my name, I will do it." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
We now confess our faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ,
the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God
of very God,
begotten,
not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. And the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures and ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end.
And
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. At this time, the congregation may be seated, and I ask the kids to come up for a quick chat with me. What? You're not coming? All right. Thank you. Where's your sister? Oh, okay. Oh, there she is. Good timing. Okay, nice to see you, folks. And welcome, Ezra. Good to see you. Happy birthday, a little belated. All right. Okay, so today to the congregation, I'm going to preach on the gospel reading where Jesus said, "I am the way and the truth and the life." And there's a lot of stuff that Jesus talks about here. There's so much that I can't talk about it in one sermon. So the very end of the gospel reading here, I'm going to talk to you about, which is where Jesus talks about prayer. Okay? Now, I'm assuming, hoping, that you guys all pray every day. I do. I pray a lot during the day. And I also pray when I first get up in the morning, and I pray when I go to bed. And one of the things about prayer is that Jesus told us that we are to pray because he's invited us to. He wants to hear from us. And it reminds us that he's there looking out for us and all that good stuff. And something else that we should note about prayer is we shouldn't just pray for ourselves, but pray for other people. For example, I pray for all of you guys and for everyone in the church. And I pray for those who are sick and in need of healing. And I pray for our country and stuff like that. And I also ask God to help me when my hip hurts or my knee is giving me problems or stuff like that, okay? That too. All right? Now, when we pray, sometimes our prayers can be a shopping list. And that shouldn't be the way it is. It shouldn't be, God, give me this, give me that, give me, give me that, give me that. That shouldn't be our prayers. We need to pray for other people. And, of course, we ask for God for help with our stuff. And then we end our prayers by saying, your will be done in Jesus' name, amen. Now, he said here, whatever you ask in my name, this I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask me anything in my name, I will do it. So does that mean that if I pray with you here in a minute and I ask God to give me a Lamborghini, do you know what a Lamborghini is? It's a very fancy car, all right? The car would be worth more than my house is, okay? If I say to God, please give me a Lamborghini, is he going to give me one? No, because I don't need a Lamborghini. I wouldn't mind having one, but I'd actually rather have a Civic Type R, but anyway, which is a Honda. But God is not going to give me something I don't need. He's not going to give you something you don't need. He gives us everything we need and some of the things we want. So where it says here, if you ask anything in my name, when he says in my name, that also means if it's my will. And so when Jesus answers our prayers, and he answers every prayer, sometimes the answer is yes. Sometimes the answer is no. And sometimes the answer is not yet. Okay? So if you ask for something that you don't need and God says no, don't hold that against him, because God makes sure you have everything you need and some of the things you just want. Okay? And of course, the biggest thing we need is that Jesus died on the cross and rose again to take away our sins. That he has given us. Okay? All right. So everybody, fold your hands. Repeat after me. Dear Jesus,
thank you
for your love. Thank you
for taking away
our sins.
Thank you
for listening to us.
We love you, Jesus.
Bless us all.
Amen.
All right, thanks for coming up. We will now continue with our new song of the month.
Christ is my firm foundation, the rock on which I stand. When everything around me shaking, I've never been more glad that I put my faith in Jesus. Cause he's never let me down, he's faithful through He won't. I've still got joy in chaos. I've got peace that makes no sense, so I won't be going under. I'm not held by my own strength, cause I've built my life on Jesus.
He won't. He won't. He won't fail. He won't In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The text for your sermon this morning, the biblical basis for our thoughts together here today, are the words of the gospel reading, which I read a few moments ago, the Gospel of John, 14th chapter, beginning with verse 1. I'm assuming that we have this in common, that we have all heard somebody say something, and our reaction to that is we hear that and go, no way. For example, last January, the president said in his State of the Union address that take-home pay has gone up. I don't know if that's true for you, but inflation has hit our family pretty hard. Grocery prices and stuff are way higher than they were 2 years ago. So when I heard him say that, I said, no way. Another example. You may have heard of this guy, Aaron Rodgers. Used to play quarterback for the Green Bay Packers for 18 years. And he's been saying he has no problem with the Green Bay Packers front office and management. Of course, they've now traded him to the New York Jets. But he refused to take their phone calls for 3 months. No way. And another example that I could give of somebody saying something like this, and I would say no way, is whenever anyone has said to me, I hate bacon. Now, I actually do know somebody who has said this, and this is where they're from and coming from. And my first thought when I heard this was, wow, that's really kind of sad. But then I thought, more for me. So now, there's a reason why I'm bringing this up this morning. There are things that Jesus says in the gospel today that could lead to that sort of reaction. There are folks who hear Jesus, like where he's talking today in chapter 14, and think, where does a nobody carpenter from a nowhere place like Nazareth and nowhere Galilee get the gall to make a statement like, I am the way and the truth and the life? Some people hear that and go, no way. Does Jesus really have access to the Father's house? Can he really take us there? Well, we know the answer is yes. In today's gospel, Jesus makes statements that ought to take your breath away because of their boldness and their magnitude. Because Jesus says he is the Son of the Heavenly Father. He says he's the Son of God. And he backs up this claim here and throughout the Gospels with statements and deeds that make a simple point. All that the Father says and does is demonstrated and shown in Jesus. And so today we're going to see the proof of the old saying that goes, like Father, like Son. Now, like I was saying, there are people in our world, maybe people in our neighborhoods, who wonder why we should believe that Jesus is God. And a lot of people look at Jesus, they'll say, well, he's an unusual teacher, a moral person, a man of wisdom, but they go no further than that. But why should we think that Jesus is God? Well, I'll tell you. Because Jesus speaks God's word, and Jesus does God's works. So first, let's talk about how Jesus speaks the words of God. Jesus said so himself. Verse 10 in our text. The words I say to you, I do not speak in my own authority, but the Father who dwells in me does his works. And later in the chapter, now this is in verse 24, so this is not in your bulletin. But later in the chapter, Jesus says, and the words that you hear are not mine, but the Father's who sent me. And so while Jesus said some amazing things, he never said that he was the source of things. He repeatedly said that he was sent and that he was saying what his heavenly Father and ours told him to say. Unlike many false prophets, Jesus was humble. He was content to be the servant sent from heaven to relay God's message and be God's message. And the modern false prophets, of which there are many, and whenever I think of that topic, I think of people like Sun Myung Moon, and you got to have a few gray hairs to remember him, or maybe David Koresh. Those guys were anything but humble. So, as part of this sermon for you today, I decided to do a little research into false messiahs, and you would be surprised at how many people out there are proclaiming that they're Jesus. I have a few examples for you here today. There is a guy named Miller. He lives in Australia. And he says he is Jesus. He says he remembers being crucified, but he doesn't remember how to speak Aramaic anymore. And he also said that by now Australia would be underwater, which it's not. So I don't really think he's Jesus because Jesus would know Aramaic, and whenever Jesus made a prophecy, it happened. So I don't think Miller is who he says he is. There was a guy from Puerto Rico who moved to Miami, and he said that he is Jesus and the Antichrist. That's an interesting combination. And he says there is no sin, there is no devil, and there's no hell. So I don't know how he can be the Antichrist and not believe in hell. Well, anyway, he contradicts Scripture, so obviously he's not Jesus. Okay. There's a guy in Brazil who says that he is Jesus reincarnated. Although first he said he was Nostradamus, and he said that the idea that Jesus was resurrected was absurd. Well, obviously he's not Jesus because Jesus isn't dead, therefore you can't be reincarnated, right? And here's, I don't want to say he's my favorite, but I think this guy's the most interesting. There's a guy in Siberia who says that he is Jesus reincarnated, here to finish what Jesus started. And although he also said Jesus is not God, and he also teaches, and remember, he lives in Siberia, okay? So he also teaches that the bitter winds there help people build character. Okay? But again, there's nothing scriptural in what he's teaching there. And he actually has quite a following, which is really scary. And then there was a guy, my last example, there was a guy in prison in New Mexico City, in New Mexico, who believes he is God and man united, and that the day he dies will be the end of the world. Well, I think it will be maybe for him, but not for the rest of us. Okay. They all claim to be Jesus in some form, but none of them say they're here to serve. It's their expectation that their flock, whoever they may be, will serve them. But you know, false prophets make demands. Jesus came to serve. And what Jesus had to say were the words of eternal life. Do you remember that quote? Many of Jesus' disciples, one day, this is in John chapter 6, Jesus had fed the 5,000, and he was preaching, and he was teaching, and one of the things that he said during that discussion was that in order to be saved, you must eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood. He was referring to communion. But a lot of his listeners went, ooh, we're not going to follow him anymore, even though he had just fed them. And a lot of people left him that day. And so then Jesus looks at the 12, and he looks at them and he says, are you going to leave me too? But Peter got up and said, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. Now, the skeptic can say anyone could claim to be speaking for God, and some of those guys I was talking about do claim that. But here's the thing. Another way that we know Jesus is who he says he is not just because of what he says, but because of what he does. Jesus did things only God can do. Jesus does things only God can do. And in verse 10, again, we look and see where Jesus says, but the Father who dwells in me does his works. For example, Jesus has the power to give life. And think about all the times in the Bible where Jesus did this. He came upon a funeral for a boy who was the last remaining relative of a woman in a town called Nain. And Jesus just walked up to the coffin, he touched the coffin, and immediately the kid came back to life. Jairus, a synagogue official, came to Jesus and said, please come to my home and heal my sick daughter. And so Jesus went to his house, but by the time he got there, the girl had died. But Jesus just took her by the hand and told her, in Aramaic, little girl, get up. And she did. Lazarus got sick and died and was in the tomb for 4 days. And yet all Jesus had to do was say, Lazarus, come out. And he did. It seems to me that only God has the power over life and death. And for the skeptics out there that say, well, I don't think that happened. There were thousands of witnesses of these things. And 4 of those guys wrote this stuff down. Okay? He did it. Jesus is God because he has the power over life and death. And I believe I've mentioned this to you before, but I'm going to do again here. Have you ever been to a funeral where there's, you know, somebody's remains there in the coffin, and in the middle of the funeral, that person got up out of the coffin, got out, and walked out of the church? You ever seen that? Hands. Anybody see that? No? You know anybody that can make that happen? I don't. If you know somebody that can do that, I'd like you to introduce them to me. Now, there are some gene-splitting, pig-cloning, amoeba-making scientists who think that they can beat God at this game and try and create life, but only God has this power. And so now some scientists are out there trying to build a sentient computer and creating an artificial life. Is there anybody in this room that thinks that's a good idea? I mean, because we're hearing all about all this AI stuff these days. Have these guys in Silicon Valley or whoever they're working on this, have they not seen the movies I've seen? Have they not seen 2001 A Space Odyssey? Have they not seen Colossus, The Foreman Project? Have they not seen War Games and The Whopper? Have they not seen The Terminator and Skynet? And if you haven't seen any of these movies, they're all about computers that try and kill people. All right. Oh, there's Demon Seed. I forgot about that one. Anyway. The Bible also tells us that not only that Jesus has the power over life and death, but he took part in the creation of the world. So because he did that, nature is also under his control. We see that in the Gospels, because he calmed storms. He walked on water. And the Bible also tells us that he's the judge of the world, that he's the savior of the world. And these are things that we cannot do. Only God can do them. Jesus himself said it. I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live, even though he dies, and whoever lives and believes in me will never die. And it isn't just that Jesus has God power. It isn't just that Jesus spoke the truth. Jesus is the truth. Jesus is God. He said, I am the way and the truth. And we live in a time where a lot of people believe that you know, they say that you can believe anything you want, that whatever you think is true is true. And so we have government people and others telling us that the way to stop inflation is for the government to start spending a lot more money. That's not true. We have people telling us that men can have babies now. Well, Jesus is the truth. And Jesus is the only way to heaven. And so we should listen to what God says to us. We need to listen to what Jesus tells us. And I know at this point of the sermon you're thinking, well, yeah, I know that, Pastor, but we don't always do it, do we? I've had people tell me over 30 years of ministry, gee, Pastor, you preach the gospel, and golly, you do a good job of it, but I know the gospel. You should preach on something else. And my stock answer to that is, I will stop preaching on the gospel when we all start living like we know the gospel, because we don't do that. It's very easy for us to not listen to Jesus, to not listen to God, and to listen to somebody else. And a lot of times when we listen to somebody else, whether it is an actual another person or just listening to ourselves, a lot of times when we listen to someone other than Jesus, we get bad advice. And so when I was preparing this sermon for you, I thought when I got to this point in the sermon, I'm like, you know what? I'm going to go on the internet and see if I can find some good examples of bad advice. And I found a lot. So here's some of what I found. I've got some examples for you here. I read on the internet about a guy who got an iPhone. When the iPhone switched from having the headphone jack to no headphone jack, now, if you've had an iPhone for many, many years, you know they always had a little plug on the top, and then they took that out, and it made people mad. You had to go buy some adapter to plug it into the charging port, and then you could plug a set of headphones into your phone. You Apple people know what I'm talking about, right? Okay. So this guy got an iPhone that did not have the headphone jack, and he wanted one. So someone gave him the advice, just drill a hole in the bottom of your phone. It's bad advice. Saw this example. A parent said to her child, "Don't climb that wall. If you fall and break both of your legs, don't you come running to me." Actually, the advice there is okay. It's what mom said after that wasn't so great. Another person said they were given this advice. I thought this was interesting. If you think your boyfriend is about to break up with you, tell him you're pregnant. That always fixes everything. I think that's bad advice. Someone confessed this. This is for all you car people out there. Someone put this on the internet, said, "I was a senior in high school, and someone told me that my blinker was out on my car and that I needed blinker fluid." There's no fluid in your blinkers. It's just a light bulb. "Well, I went to AutoZone," he said, "and asked for it." That was definitely bad advice. All right, here's another one. I got a couple more here. Here's another one. This person shared, "When I was in Boy Scouts, our scout leader said that we should use those leaves for toilet tissue. It was poison ivy." That's certainly bad advice. And here's my last one. "When we were younger, I convinced my little brother who had gotten a cut, and you know, mom always says if you have a cut, you need to wash it out. I told my little brother to use salt to scrub the dirt out of his cut." Yeah, that was bad advice. So with this and all the other things that I found, because I found a bunch, I learned two things in my internet search. One, there is a lot of bad advice out there. And two is that some people are really mean. You know, rubbing salt in the wound to clean it out, that sibling didn't like their brother very much. But there's a lot of bad advice out there. And we see in the Bible a lot of people who listened and did according to bad advice. Starting with Adam and Eve, Satan said, "Go ahead and eat that. You'll be like God." Bad advice. The people of the flood died when they listened to bad advice and failed to repent. Thousands of the children of Israel died when they followed bad advice and made a golden calf. And here's one that you may not know as well. Rehoboam. I don't know how many of you know who Rehoboam was. He was the king who followed Solomon. All right. So Solomon, when he died, Israel was as strong politically and militarily as it ever was. But then he died, and Rehoboam took over. And all of the leaders and advisors, well, not all the advisors, but a lot of the people in the court went to Rehoboam and said, look, your dad charged a lot in taxes, which he did because they built castles and palaces and temples and what have you. And to build these things, Solomon would draft young men not to do military work, but to build these things. And so people went to Rehoboam and they said, you need to lighten up on the taxes. You need to lighten up on these policies and give the people a little bit of a break. And so Rehoboam went to his father's advisors and said, what should I do? And they said, yeah, you should lower the taxes and give the people a break. Your dad was kind of hard on the people there at the end. But then Rehoboam's friends said, if they think that your dad was harsh, you need to be harsher. Give it to them. Let them have it. And so Rehoboam listened to his friends, and that resulted in the kingdom being split in two, and the 10 tribes of the north went this way, and the 2 tribes of the south went this way, and they've been divided ever since. The 10 tribes were conquered by the Assyrians, and they don't exist anymore because Rehoboam took such bad advice. So if you look through Scripture, you'll find that it'll be hard for you to find somebody who didn't listen to bad advice. Indeed, it would be impossible to find such a person, impossible until you look at Jesus. Because Jesus resisted all bad advice, because he did only his Father's will, all who believe in him have forgiveness of sins and a home waiting in heaven. And sadly, there are billions of people today who do not believe in him. According to recent statistics, there are approximately 8 billion people in the world. 2 billion are Christian, which means 6 billion aren't. So there are many who still get sucked in by bad advice. And some follow the bad advice which says there is no God. And others embrace the bad advice which says all God's religions are the same. But Jesus said, I am the way and the truth and the life. Not a way, the way. And he backed it up by what he did and who he did it for. When Jesus says something, we should never doubt it. Jesus has never lied to us. He's never broken a promise to us. And when he says to us that God the Father sent him, bank on it. And when he says that he is our Savior, bank on that too. Okay. So to put everything together here, we go back to the beginning where I said like Father, like Son. Because Jesus said everything he was doing was what the Father told him to do. He is like Father, like Son, right? So as you know, I think you all know, Erica and I have 2 charming, delightful, obedient children. That's actually not sarcasm. They pretty much are. But when they were little, it was my prayer that my hope that my children would not be too much like me, because when I thought back to what I was like as a kid, well, I was a real nerd. But let's just say that if you know me and you know them, well, DNA doesn't lie. They're definitely a chip off the old block in their own ways, right? It's just like I have some of my father's traits, like having a lot of patience. My dad was really patient, and so am I. This is where Erica is supposed to go, ha! Thank you. Actually, I do have traits from my father, including the fact that he had no patience, and I don't either. Okay? But we rejoice in a Savior who was just like his father, because Jesus is who he says he is and did what he did, because he is the way and the truth and the life, because he died and rose for us. He will also make good on his promise to do what he said when he said, I am going to my Father's house to prepare a place for you. I will come again and will take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. That's a promise. Believe it. It's the truth. In the name of Jesus, amen. And may the peace of God, which surpasses all human understanding, may keep our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus unto life everlasting. Amen. Heavenly Father, please bless and receive these gifts which we give back to you from that which you have first given to us. Amen. We stand for the prayers and petitions of our congregation. Let us pray for the whole Church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Heavenly Father, through the power of Christ's resurrection, you adopt all who believe in him. Receive us as your children and nourish our faith through the pure spiritual milk of your word, that we may dwell in your presence forever. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, build up the households of your people, that your holy children, begotten in baptism, may grow in your grace and share together in your forgiveness and life. Lord, in your mercy. Holy God, your power brought all things into being and still preserves what you have made. Bless Joseph, our president, the Congress of these United States, Kevin, our governor, and all elected and appointed civil servants. Lead them to honor you and your purpose, establishing order and justice, encouraging virtue, and protecting all life. Give them wisdom and moderation to lead for the well-being of the nation. We also pray for those who serve in our military, including Tyler, Thomas, Chris, Matthew, and Preston, Evan, Cannon, Teresa, David, and Maya, Chris, John, Ben, Debbie, and Seth, Kendon, Christian, and Jacob, Jonathan, Nick, and Hyojin. Lord, in your mercy. Merciful Heavenly Father, bless the sick, the sorrowing, the anxious, the fearful, the homebound, the homeless, the dying, and all who have requested our prayers. We pray for those who are in our bulletin insert here this morning, and we take a moment and pray silently in our hearts for all those that we know to be in need of your grace and mercy this morning. At the last, give them entrance into your heavenly kingdom. Lord, in your mercy. Father of the risen Christ, you give us the crucified and risen body and blood of our Lord in this holy supper. Let us taste that the Lord is good and continually grow up unto salvation. Lord, in your mercy. Blessed are you, Lord of heaven and earth, for you've had mercy on those whom you created and sent your only begotten Son into our flesh to bear our sin and be our Savior. With repentant joy, we receive the salvation accomplished for us by the all-availing sacrifice of his body and his blood on the cross. Gathered in the name and the remembrance of Jesus, we beg you, O Lord, to forgive, renew, and strengthen us with your word and spirit. Grant us faithfully to eat his body and drink his blood, as he bids us to do in his own testament. Gather us together, we pray, from the ends of the earth, to celebrate with all the faithful the marriage feast of the Lamb in his kingdom, which has no end. Graciously receive our prayers, deliver and preserve us. To you alone, O Father, be all glory, honor, and worship with the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Hear us as we pray in his name and as he has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, in the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
The feast of the Lord is prepared for the people of the Lord. Come to the feast. We stand for prayer. We pray. We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through this salutary gift, and we implore you that of your mercy you would strengthen us through the same, in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give you peace. Amen. Remain standing for our closing song. Blessed be something. Blessed be your name. That's it. Sometimes it just goes blank. Wait till you're my age, people. God's people said, Amen. Thank you very much for joining us here this morning. As always, God be with you and bless you this day and this week.